Hi students, welcome to EPG Paathshala project. Let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Bindu B, working as assistant professor in Marthyophilus Training College, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Today, we are going to discuss about the economic perspectives of education. Let me start the module on economic principles of education. The main objectives of this module are, first, to explain and define the concept of economics. Second, to explain and define the concept of education. Third, to analyze the impact of economics upon education. Fourth, to understand the concept economic principles of education. And finally, to elaborate the concept of education as a public good and basic need. We all are familiar with the subject of economics. All of us have studied the subject in our school days as a compulsory subject. As economics constitute one of the major components of social science, which form an essential part of school curriculum. Even though the subject is included in the humanities group, the subject is closely related to scientific disciplines which act as a tool for modernization and economic development of the nation. In the modern world, economics has been elevated to very high position because of the special nature of the subject and especially because of the changing pattern of global economy in the midst of scientific and technological advancement. For example, the recession experienced by the world economies point to the fact that science and technology should go hand in hand with economics. Do you know about the history of economics? Economics has been derived from the Greek word oikonomia, which the ancient Greeks used to signify the art of prudent and systematic household management with particular reference to wants of the members of the society. In India, the history of the subject can be traced back long ago with the publication of the book Arthashastra by Kaudilya, which is a treatise on economics. Similar to many other subjects, the subject has got its own significance. You know why? The subject is of crucial importance since economic activities have become the basis of all human activities. The ability to use basic economic skills in everyday life has now accepted as one of the aspects of life skill education. What does it mean? True, economics is a subject which has practical as well as economic value. It is helpful in solving the practical and economic problems of life. Now a question will definitely arise in your mind, whether it is a science or an art. Economics is a science as well as an art. Why is it considered as a science? As a science, it studies the economic activities of man as a social being. And as an art, it tries to solve various practical problems in everyday life. So it says that if an economist is a scientist, he should be able to predict significant events. If he is an artist, he should be able to control and shape future events. This statement signifies both the aspect of economics education. Now we shall recollect the subject matter of economics. Our daily experience leads us to a point that it is a subject which is concerned with the study of production and distribution of resources. As we know, resources are of two types, physical goods and intangible services. Physical goods are the commodities having a physical shape that can be felt, smelled, tasted, and used. Some common examples are book, television, etc. Services are also a type of economic activity that is intangible and which cannot be stored. Some examples are the service rendered by the teacher, doctor, etc. We consider these as economic activities. What are the result of this economic action? Economic action result in the accumulation and management of physical assets, namely wealth. The concept of wealth underwent a scientific analysis with the publication of the book An Enquiry into the Nature and Causes of Wealth of Nation by Adam Smith, who is regarded as the father of economics. After Adam Smith, it was Alfred Marshall who attempted to give another definition of economics. Alfred Marshall defined economics as a study of man in the ordinary business of life. It inquires how he gets his income and how he uses it. Hence, economics become the study of wealth as well as the study of welfare of man. This leads to the welfare concept in economics. To the modern century economist, the subject seems entirely different. The modern century economists like Leonard Robbins defined economics as a science which studies human behavior as a relationship between ends and scarce means, which have alternative uses. Again, it leads to concept of scarcity in economics. The present century identified the emerging needs of the society and the new concept evolved centers on economics as a science of sustainable development. According to this concept, economics is the storehouse of human experience which are concerned with the proper use and allocation of resources for the achievement and maintenance of growth and stability. Now let us discuss about the subject of education. You all may be familiar with the meaning of education. Various thinkers have contributed on important dimensions of education. A number of definitions may come to your mind. In the simplest sense, education is the process of training and developing the knowledge, skill, mind, character, etc., especially by formal schooling. It is the Webster's New World Dictionary definition. Let us correlate our knowledge in economics with that of education. From economic point of view, education involves production and distribution of knowledge, either in the regular institution of learning or elsewhere. Economists view education as present investment for future earning. The significance of education in the economic development has been recognized ever since the dawn of human civilization. In the words of Plato, education is indispensable to economic health of a good society, for education makes citizens reasonable men. Do you know why it is said so? Education transforms raw human resources into skilled manpower or human capital. So we can consider education as a man-making process, and the expenses incurred is considered as an investment. Investment in human resources is widely recognized owing to its high significance in the overall development of the society. Alfred Marshall viewed education as a national investment, and in his opinion, the most valuable of all capital is that invested in human beings. Education equipped manpower for the process of economic growth. The famous economist Schulz viewed education as not merely a consumption activity, but as an investment. It leads to formation of human capital, making a significant contribution to economic growth. So far, we came to know about the two different subjects, economics and education. We understand that some connections are there between the two subjects. What will be the result? Will it lead to a new branch of study? Yes, it gave birth to a specialized study known as economics of education. We saw education and economics has got a positive relationship. As the relevance of education is increasing day by day, the economic inputs necessary for the implementation of the educational programs and in turn, the consequent impact of the educational programs are highly significant. It is in this immense relationship asserted by both subjects that led to the formation of a new branch of knowledge known as economics of education. According to Bablow, economics of education is the study of economic variables relating to education, including the demand for education and the financing and provision of education. In other words, economics of education studies human behavior, that is, in terms of human decision, actions, and reactions about schooling. Economics of education analyzes both what determines or creates education and what impact education has on individuals and on the society on which they live. In the words of Philip Coombs, education of the country can be viewed as a brain power industry, which turns out human beings as instruments for building national and economic strength. Education can act as an important media of economic growth. The strong relationship between education and economics will result in the development of societies in terms of economic development, poverty reduction, life expectancy, and infant mortality. In the words of our former Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, education must enable the individual to be a good producer as well as a good citizen. Now you understand where there exists a link between these two subjects. And this link between education and economic growth proves to be vital in the path of development of nations. The education, especially of the girls and women, has strong downward impact on the fertility rates, helping to relieve demographical pressures. To make this clear, let me take the condition of Kerala. India Census 2011 shows that Kerala is a model for its achievement in population control. Kerala has now reached the third stage of demographic transition characterized by low birth and death rate. The educational achievement of the state of Kerala, amongst other states, throw light on the fact that education of girls and women translates into lower child mortality rates and adoption of better health measures for the whole family. More than demographical achievements, investment in education contributes to greater social cohesion and more informed and effective citizens, and thus lowering crimes and social evils. Let us have a detailed look into this concept. It is true advanced economic conditions progressively contribute to the educational advancement of its citizens. But how? Parental education and better earning profiles call for higher standards of living and further advancement of education. Realizing the importance of education in the rapid economic development of the nation, the Secondary Education Commission has observed that the aim of secondary education is to train the youth of the country to be good citizens who will be competent enough to play their part effectively in the social reconstruction and economic development of the country. education has been and will continue to be the potential cause for change in any society. The level of education of the masses influence the economy of the nation, and the economic conditions exert the demand for highly educated, skilled persons. The relevance of the subject in the present century is highly significant. Economics of education is the study of how men and society, with or without the use of money, to employ, choose training, the development of knowledge, skill, mind, character, etc., especially by schooling, formal over time, and designate them now in the future among various peoples and groups in society. Economics of education is concerned with the process by which education is produced, what type of education activities is to be chosen, how much money, that is resources, should be allocated or spent by society or by any individual to educational activities. How should the scarcely available education be distributed among competing groups and individuals? Economics of education will deal with answers to these and similar questions. A detailed analysis of the subject is necessary to make this point clear. There are certain areas where we can see the impact of these two subjects. First, with regard to the aim of education, economics determine aims of education. Beside knowledge aim, cultural aim, character aim, spiritual aim, social aim, harmonious development of personality as an aim, vocational aim is one of the important aims of education, which is the matter of concern for the economist. Another area of impact lies in the importance of education. Much importance is given to education, as the economic growth of the country is largely dependent on educational development. Third aspect point out that education as a means. Economic teaches man to be a better producer, both for his personal good and for the good of the country. It further points out that education is a means for that end. Next is education as an investment. It is considered as an investment because it yields returns. Many more areas of impact are there which says education as a guarantee of economic security, in the sense that education determines professional values, the wage structure, and guarantees economic security of the people. A close area of impact is on the education and economic status. That is, economic status of a person is determined by education. Education helps in possessing a good earning capacity and leading a good economic life. Lastly, education and economic prosperity. As we discussed earlier, economic development of the country depends on education. Economic prosperity of the country is directly proportional to the educational development of the people. All these point to the education-economics linkage. Education can be viewed as a process that has close relationship with that of economic process. Many concepts in education needs to be analyzed from the economic dimension. The major theoretical tools employed in economics are simultaneously used in education scenario also. We know the key economic processes are technological choice and consumption. From the economic point of view, education can be considered as that of a resource which needs to be produced and distributed properly. While viewing education as an economics needs to be clarified because resources are scarce and wants are unlimited. Hence, there arises a problem of choice in decision making in education. These resources are employed to produce goods and services in the society. Do you know which one is the main resource? Yes, the human resources. According to Adam Smith, education is a kind of capital which embodies acquired knowledge and skills. What does it imply? Economics analysis of education is needed. First, dimension is education as an investment. As we enter the 21st century, it is clear that education is indeed the best investment that we can make for an information economy that depends upon knowledgeable, skilled, and educated workforce. According to Webster's dictionary, investment is a thing that is worth buying because it may be profitable or useful in future. Education can be considered as an investment in human beings which can yield returns in future. Next is education as consumption. Education as consumption leads to the fact that education is a fundamental human right or is one of the democratic rights of every citizen. So, a certain level of procurement should be done by the government. Therefore, in many countries, basic education, that is primary and secondary school, were considered as compulsory education. Then coming to the cost of education, what is cost of education? That expenditure incurred on education can be considered as the cost of education. This can be private cost and social cost. The private course refers to the expenses incurred for school, fees, books, clothing and related costs that a student or family must bear. The social course refers to the cost which is incurred for the society as a whole, which result when there arises the need to finance costly education expansion in higher levels with limited fund, which can be productively used in other sectors of the economy. If there incurs any cost, definitely there will be some benefits also. Yes, the benefits of education. Here, benefits refers to the rate of return that can be yielded from the amount invested in education, which can be public benefits and private benefits. The rate of return is hard to define or measure. Theoretically, if you could measure all the money you could make after a college education and compare to that of the money you would have made without the education, the difference is the value of the education. It is good investment if the cost of the education is less than the value. What are the public benefits? They are literacy, increasing democracy, producing leaders, productivity, favorable effects on society, social norms, human resource development, etc. We know private benefits are also there, which can be monetary and non-monetary. The monetary benefits are removing poverty, then wages and allowances, better working conditions are there, better jobs are there, then non-monetary, that is making wise decisions, culture, values, information, knowledge, communication, skills, etc. Next, we will have the education as an industry. The industrial concern of education is accepted on two grounds, employment and economic growth. Now, you may be clear why education is considered as an investment or how education could accelerate economic growth, that is, by producing economically efficient citizens, scientific and technological progress, creating opportunities, removing poverty, skilled workers, right attitude towards learning and work, awareness for better living, increasing productivity, etc. Education is like a big industry that uses up material and human resources. It is more a public sector industry than a private one, and it is closely linked with national development. Like any other industry, it has both inputs and outputs. It inputs like land, building, materials, book, school equipments and services of teachers are bought in the market. But unlike industrial output, the output of the education system are not sold in the market. Education is no longer left to the individual's ability to pay for it. It has been recognized in all democracies as a basic right to be supported and protected by the government. This is because the state has four key roles to play. First, to provide public goods. Second, to correct market imperfections. Third, to ensure equitable distribution of income. Fourth, to provide economic stability. All this make clear that education is meant for public welfare. We have already discussed about the benefits of education. There may be individual benefits and also at the same time social benefits. Those who acquire education could lead a better life than one who do not acquire. That is, consumers of education confer external benefits. The social benefits is enjoyed by the society as a whole. A country with large higher educated population will lead to an increase in GNP. It is also argued that social benefits of education cannot be reduced to individual self-interest. Hence, by taxing those who receive these benefits and subsidizing the provision of education, the welfare of both the rich and the poor groups and thereby the society as a whole can be improved. This may result in improvement in health, reduction in population growth, reduction in poverty, improvement in income distribution, reduction in crime, rapid adoption of new technologies, strengthening of democracy, and ensuring of civil liberties. Now you might be clear why the state plays a powerful role in education. The externalities of the education are regarded to be a legion. Further, when viewed democracy, reduction of crime, economic growth, redistribution of resources, etc., are other public goods. It is important to note that education helps in their fulfillment. Hence, the government should make some provision for the free supply of education to all, which calls for the education as a basic need. According to United Nations Environment Programme, the basic needs for a satisfactory human existence are universal. The physical needs of food, shelter, and clothing, and the social ones, education, creative employment, individual freedom and ability to participate in the prevailing social system. To be denied of any of these needs is to be denied of the prospect of a fulfilled life. Considering this aspect, World Bank has described education as a basic human need that enables one to respond to new opportunities, to adjust to changing situations, to acquire new skills, enhancing productivity and income, and to create and manage resources that accelerate the overall development. Other than education, there are some other basic needs such as health, food, water supply, sanitation, health and hygiene, etc., which are usually referred as social indicators. Among these factors, education occupies a pivotal position. Everything is knitted around the quantum of knowledge available. The level of education of the society has a direct impact on the standard of living, health and hygiene, family planning measures, prevention of diseases, etc. Hence, education is regarded as a potential instrument of national development. Independent India's first education minister, Dr. Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad, has rightly remarked in an educational conference in 1948 that it was the birthright of every individual to receive at least basic education, without which he cannot fully discharge his duties as a citizen. When people are educated, we not only get teachers, professionals and executives, but more importantly, citizens who are aware, sensitive and responsible. It makes people place social goals above personal goals. So we can conclude that education is a fundamental human right as well as a catalyst for economic growth and human development. Education plays a very important role in molding the character of an individual. It is one of the concrete sources from which one gets information and knowledge. Human development may lead to the national development. It is through education that a nation transmits its heritage, recreates its culture, strengthens its economy, and conserves its values. It is a means of promoting individual excellence. It is a process of enriching human beings by systematically imparting knowledge, skills, training in life in different capacities. Education is the means for preparing persons for the future. It will equip them with the tools to deal with different tasks that will be needed in their life. This will equip them for private life, but equally be prepared to participate in economic life, cultural life, and political life of society. So, dear students, let us join hands in the movement for giving education to every child, thereby developing our nation and ourselves. Thank you.